Good afternoon. I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. My name is Craig Gleckler. I'm the marketing manager at CUES, and I'll also be your host for today. For today's topic, we will be discussing the operation and maintenance of our new CUES micro pan and tilt inspection camera, as well as a few other cameras in that category. This presentation will be approximately 45 minutes. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our speaker for today's presentation, Mr. Larry Corkle. Larry, take it away.
Thank you, Craig. I work up in the Toronto office for CUES. I've been with CUES for 33 years. I've done probably everything in this place except for accounting. Worked on the shop floor, production, had a little bit to do with some engineering of cables and cameras in the early day. And of course, now I'm in sales and work in the Canadian division, overseeing the sales and service up here. Yeah, so today we're going to talk about the launch cameras for the lateral launcher of CUES. There's three basic models. There's the SR3 PS3, which is shown on the left. The SR stands for self-righting, so they look very similar. And then we have two small pan and tilt cameras. The original one is shown on the right, and that's the mini pan and tilt. And then we've come out with a newer, smaller version, which is shown in the middle, which is the micro pan and tilt. We're going to talk about the operation, the maintenance, and some troubleshooting on all of these cameras. When we start, we need to be able to ensure that our power supply is set up correctly. On the right-hand side of the screen, you'll see there's a camera choice. The original versions had a choice of SR3, which would also run the PS3 camera, or the pan and tilt camera. As time went on and we created the newer, smaller pan and tilt, the micro, we added to the overlay that it would also take the SR3 power. The SR3 micro pan and tilt, PS3, run on 20 volts. So it's on that setting, as you see in the bottom right. And the mini pan and tilt, the original larger version, runs on 24 volts. So you would change the setting to the PNT or mini pan and tilt, mini PNT to run that. The micro pan and tilt uses a higher voltage, and its motor power and its light power would both come from the dial on the left-hand side of that same panel, and it would generally be set to approximately the 3 o'clock position. We're going to talk about the settings for each of those three cameras, and you can see in these three slides, which are the K2 Summit setup screens, and each of those screens is going to be slightly different, possibly, in your configuration. We happen to be using the R043 software version in this presentation. If you're using the small straight line camera, the SR3 PS3, you would set the lateral camera to the word standard. If you're using the original miniature pan and tilt, you would change the lateral to mini pan and tilt. And if you're using the newest, smallest camera with a pan and tilt, you would change this to micro. Why do we have three cameras? What is the choices? The smallest camera, the original that things came out with, has a much smaller footprint, a much lighter camera. This is going to allow you to get up into more difficult laterals from the main. You have a lot of encrustation where the entrance is significantly smaller, or a really protruding lateral. This is going to allow you to get up into the lateral easier. You're going to be able to negotiate more bends because you're pushing less weight. So the more weight you were pushing, the fewer bends you're going to be able to make it around. So if you're going into an area that has a tremendous amount of bends before you make it to the clean out up in the house, then you may choose to use the SR3 camera. This camera has an outer diameter of 1.9 inches. And it's kind of funny when you're me coming from the service world, you spent a lot of time, effort, money in order to get a camera smaller and smaller and smaller. And then the first thing we had to do was create a sleeve to make it larger. Reason being, if you go into a dirty lateral, what you're really going to do is take this very small camera and its light heads and push it up against the debris, and you're likely going to clog up your picture. So you do tend to make it a little bit larger if you're in a dirty lateral. This has a little bit of an almost oval shape, but it is larger at one end. You can choose to put it on frontwards or backwards, and it's a little bit more effective depending on the situation, one way or the other. You'll quickly discover that a good day in a lateral is not having to bring the equipment out of the hole and reset it up. And the reason is, when we get to the pan and tilts, you'll never necessarily know what size of wand to put on until you're already in and looking at the situation. So moving on to pan and tilts. We talked about the small SR3 possibly gumming up with debris. The first giant advantage of the pan and tilt would be that you can clean the lens assembly. It has a very, very small wiper in this area, and the lens of the camera is actually able to turn around and around and around in order to wipe that lens off. So you're able to clean it. You don't have to go down the line to find somewhere where some nice homeowner has been willing to flush for you in order to give it some water. And you're able to clean that off and continue up. Most importantly, you're going to be able to decide if you need to make a choice. So you're going up in a link townhouse area. You know that area has a link townhouse. So if you know that, that's the time that you decide not to use an SR3 camera, the smaller straight line, and you're going to use the larger one with the wand. That larger camera with the wand is going to allow you to choose. I want to go left. I want to go right. I want to go up. So what you're really going to do is use your pan and tilt functions of your camera. Get that wand to just stick it side inside of the hole that you wish to proceed into. And then when you continue to launch, the camera will follow the stick. The other advantage that the pan and tilt has is that you can actually lift yourself up off over offset joints with it. So if you were coming up across a large offset joint, you might just sort of butt your head up into that offset joint, where with the pan and tilt, you can rotate yourself around, use the wand to actually lift the body, the weight of the camera up, and then glide over the offset joint. This is where we're looking at the offset joint. The wand would be sticking straight up the 12 o'clock position while you're in the pipe, and then you would be able to proceed to pushing yourself along. I'm going to see if I can turn my pointer off and get the video to go. There we go. So that would be as if I was butting my head up against the joint. I lift myself up with the pan and tilt, and I'm able to push myself forward and continue on. This allows us to get over more obstructions than we would get over otherwise. Why did we come out with a micro pan and tilt? Really, that was giving us the best of both worlds. That's allowing us a smaller camera. So we're going to get into areas where we have incrustation, the intruding laterals. We're going to have a higher ability to get in. We're still going to be able to choose our left and right for our Y connections, and we'll be able to get off over offset joints. We did a job down Chicago way at one point in time, and I think that was a record for everyone, where they hit 21 laterals that they needed to go along. Effectively, they went up from the main, did a right angle bend, and then each house had its own pipe coming off of that pipe. It was almost like it created its own mini main. The other thing I wanted to point out is that this setting right here, the EC3044, and the one above it, small wheel. So on your lateral launcher, you have a choice of small wheel or large wheel. When you choose large wheel, what that does is slow down the wheels and double the amount of torque. But you're going to put on the larger pneumatic tires, so you're going to cover a lot more distance with one revolution of the wheel anyways. So when you're in pneumatic tire mode, you're going to choose large wheels. If you have one of our original launchers, it would be a model LM350. Then you don't need to use this setting EC3044. It won't really matter if you do. But if you have a newer launcher, or you've had your camera module changed out during service, you do need to use the EC3044 setting. What that really is telling you that you're using a newer camera module inside of your mainline launcher, and it needs that extra software that was added in RO42 version of software in order to adjust the focus and keep things in focus at all times. So there's your basic settings for all of the setups we're going to use for the K2 Summit. We're always going to have some setting of the lamp too. We may or may not be using the EC3044. And then of course, we've got the standard for our original straight line camera, no panning and tilting. We have the mini pan and tilt for the original slightly larger version. And then we have the new micro pan and tilt, where we would also have the setting on the small control unit to be set on the lower setting, the 20 volt micro pan and tilt setting. The lights on the micro pan and tilt are not controlled by the left knob lighting. It should be set at 3 o'clock when you're using the micro pan and tilt. The lights on the micro pan and tilt are controlled in combination with the shutter and the plus minus buttons on the left side, the D-pad of your PS2 controller. That will control the floodlights. The iris button will control the spotlights in the same manner. So you press and hold the iris button and then plus and minus on the D-pad on the left-hand side of your PS2 controller. Again, the lateral light setting would be set at approximately 3 o'clock for the micro pan and tilt. If you were using the PS3 or SR3 cameras, this power knob would also control the power for your sound on our newer model cameras. On our lateral launcher, one of my favorite options, which I don't really call an option, is a backup camera. So as opposed to plugging my 12-pin connector directly into the top of my lateral launcher, I'm going to remove it. I'm going to plug in my backup camera. In order to connect that, there'll be two screw holes on the back of the motor mounting housing. And in there will be some Allen set screws that need to be removed. The only reason they're there is to stop those holes from plugging up with dirt. So you remove those, you lower your backup camera down, and then you use the two internal screws that are part of the backup camera in order to connect the backup camera to your lateral launcher. Once you have the backup camera on your lateral launcher, we have a new tow cable, and that is different than the earliest versions of backup cameras. So I would encourage you to look at getting one of those newer tow cables. And what that ensures is that when you pull your equipment out of the manhole, you're going to be able to loop onto this metal section of the electrical connection so that you pull your strain through the mechanical connection up to where it's clamped on your clamshell to the gold, as opposed to pulling on the electrical side of the backup camera connection. We have found that in smaller pipe, the blue cable needs to smoothly go through the channel underneath the launcher in order to ensure that it doesn't slip onto one of these ovals of where the tow cable is made. The reason for that is when it possibly has to stack dimension-wise on top of this, in your very smallest setups, 6-inch, 8-inch, there is a possibility that your unit could flip over because of this getting in the way. So when you are setting up your lateral launcher for the smallest of sizes, your launch cable should always go through this triangle section of the tow cable so that it is going to have the smallest profile and the least chances of having any problems. You can see in this photo, which is in the manual, it is not connected that way. And that is certainly suitable for larger setups, 10 inch and above. This one I could spend a lot of time talking about, connection of the blue cable. And we're basically going to go in order, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So in our first picture here, where we're connecting our camera, and that wouldn't matter which model of camera it was, they're all going to have the same type of connector on the end. And we're going to plug it into our blue cable. There's a small keyed section, which they're showing here. And there's two lines attached on the edge, one on the crimp and one on the camera. The lines need to line up, the pins need to line up, so that when you tighten things up by hand, you're going to end up with pad A going to pad A, pad B going to pad B, so on and so forth, of the electrical connections. This electrical connection should be done hand tight. And then the manual does show you using a wrench. I normally say hand tight plus a little bit of an oomph, if you will. And usually when I'm teaching people, I say, that's my oomph, not your oomph. Look at my gray hair. So sometimes people put this on with the force of Hercules, and they actually can compromise these pins. They'll push them in until they won't have any balance left anymore. We will be seeing those later in the presentation. The simplest way to put this is you really do have to know your own strength and maybe know who your own audience is. I have a great story from the Canadian prairies where I had a customer, and in the early days, he was using a track crawler. And I used to tell people that if you stick your finger in, so it would come with a tool that you would use, and it would tell you how tight to make the tension, but everybody would lose the tool. So if you stuck your finger in, you just tensioned the tracks until your finger became sort of sore. Well, it didn't matter how many times I spoke with this gentleman. He'd call me again a couple of weeks later and say, I lost my track again. And I couldn't understand for the life of me why this gentleman kept losing his tracks. So sometime later, I was traveling through the demonstrator truck and I thought I should stop in and see him and see what's going on. And in all honesty, I hadn't met him face to face before. And he stuck out his hands to shake my hand. And I said, oh, I know your problem. I know what's going on. I didn't even know somebody could have fingers as large as sausages. So of course, when it hurt him, it was nowhere near tight enough and his tracks would fall off. We don't want to make that kind of mistake as we're tightening things with the wrench, but it's usually the opposite. A lot of people put it on with the force of Hercules. When we're doing telephone assistance, one of the most common things that we get is a question on how do I turn my sound on and off? Well, if you're using a mini or a micro pan and tilt, that is done with the K2 Summit software. You've probably run across the screen that you're looking at right here in your daily use. But if you haven't, where you would normally hit yes, enter to start, you would make sure that your startup configuration is on the LAMP2 setting. And instead of hitting yes, enter to start, you would hit yes, escape, and it will bring you to this screen. You're going to thumb down to utilities and hit enter and choose that. And then as long as you had your original setting, your configuration set for a LAMP2 camera, you're either going to get a choice of micro or mini pan and tilt, depending on your software function. So if you were not set up with RO42 or later, that will only say mini pan and tilt. And if you are RO42 or later, it'll say mini micro pan and tilt. So first you're going to choose utilities, and then you're going to choose mini micro pan and tilt functions. You're simply going to say, I want to turn it on. And then it will say, sound is now on. Or you're going to say, I would like to turn it off. And now your sound is off. In order for the K2 Summit to take your choice, you often have to hit the tab button and go down to your next field. In this case, the next field is the frequency selection. So on the micro pan and tilt and on the mini pan and tilt, this is where you would choose whether you want 512 or 8K. Why would you want to turn your sound on, off, change its frequencies? Why would we want to do these things? Well, if you're underground locating in a downtown location, you can often get confused between other varied utilities that happen to be nearby, completely unbeknownst to you. So the easiest thing to do is to just turn the sound off. So if you're standing out there with your locator, you turn the sound off, signal goes away, you're pretty safe that you were on the right location. If it doesn't go away, you can probably assume that you're actually locating some other buried electrical utility. The other choice that you would have with the mini cannon tilts would be to change to 8K. So you could not only see it go off and away, you could see it come back to life at a different frequency. Us and every other manufacturer used 512 because it is the only frequency that will penetrate through cast iron. So if you are in a cast iron lateral, changing to 812 is not going to help you. You'll have to turn it on and off. Only 512 will go through cast iron pipe. If you're using the SR3 and the PS3 cameras, the very first versions of those used camera power in order to power the sound. So the way to turn them off would be actually to turn the power on the LM354 controller off and back on in order to cycle the power on your pan and tilt. At that point, you will also lose video. The newer versions of those cameras, or if you've had to have a power board changed out in that camera, will use the lighting power, in which case the lighting knob that's set to 3 o'clock for the mini, for the micro pan and tilt, would increase and decrease the power requirement to the sound. Cleaning of the shroud. Probably a couple times a month, I have a unit come in and my entire repair consists of simply cleaning the shroud. So remember, as we're going up that lateral, we're collecting debris on our small PS3, SR3 cameras. We instantly had to make a big shroud to go on it to raise it up. Well, in the case of the pan and tilts, there's a much smaller shroud, which is really just there to protect the outside of the camera from being constantly worn away by running up a pipe. But in this area here, we're slowly going to collect sand and debris, and we're slowly going to grind at the camera because sand is, of course, going to become sandpaper. It's a very simple repair to clean this. It has a Phillips screwdriver right here. Two Phillips screwdrivers is all you need in order to undo the two screws. The shroud will basically fall away from the camera. And particularly in around this area, you want to be able to clean the shroud out very well and then put it all back together. Should take about 2 minutes. The sand in there is going to slowly build up over time, and it certainly needs to be cleaned out. While you're in there, you could choose to remove the socket head cap screws holding the spring on and add a little bit of contact cleaner in order to keep those electrical connections clean from the sand as well. We talked about having a wiper. So the pan and tilt has a wiper in order to help us be able to clean the lens off once we fill up full of debris. Changing the wiper is very simple. There's two screws that hold them on, and that is taken off with a 0.050 ball end socket head hex key. The next piece is a little metal piece in order to put some pressure on the rubber, which is sort of an L shape wiper. There's a bend to it, which of course will match the bend and the curve of the front of the camera. The wiper is located right in here. There is two wipers on the mini pan and tilt, and there is only one wiper on the micro pan and tilt. The ball section of the camera will rotate around and around and around unless you have the wand attachment on. If you do have the wand on, it will hit when it comes into the wiper. So in order to wipe a camera while you've got the wand on, you simply pass it as far as you can in order to wipe it and then bring it back. It would behave a lot more like a windshield wiper on your car where it goes back and forth as opposed to around and around and around forever. The spring is kind of interesting if you were to run it without the shroud. So here we have a picture of the spring without the shroud on. And if you run your camera like that, you'll kind of discover that it's really kind of the spring that rotates, not the camera. Therefore, it is kind of possible that when you're in a lateral, if you were to get stuck, and I'm thinking more like glue in the bottom of the pipe, and you were to rotate your camera, it will actually spin your blue cable if you've got lots of blue cable behind you, as opposed to spinning your camera. In that case, you may need to launch out or in order to get it unstuck from that glue. The spring on the left is for a pan and tilt. The one on the right is for an SR3 or PS3 camera. When you're replacing these, you need to align it so that A is going to go to A, B is going to go to B on the pads, which we're going to see close up shortly. On one section of the spring, you'll find there's an extra hole and there's a pin on the camera. The only way you're going to be able to connect that is to line that pin up through that extra hole. Otherwise, when the spring is connected, some of the electrical connections won't connect at all, and some of them will have a sort of connection. It's hard to explain in a very small picture, but it's a little bit more obvious in person. There's only 6 screws and 7 holes. So the 7th hole goes into the post. One of the features of the launcher is that you can immobilize the head of the launcher for mainline only operation. Why would you want to do that? This is all about lateral launching. Well, in this case, we're just going to take a moment and talk about using it as a mainline. Why would I want to do that? Maybe because I've got large pneumatic tires, so I'm going to be able to fit in a larger pipe than the mainline equipment that I happen to own will fit in. Maybe I want to be able to use my steel wheels. I'm having a lot of trouble getting through PVC pipe, and steel wheels are going to help me out. They're going to give me some grip on that PVC pipe that I otherwise wouldn't get. But if you don't immobilize the head and you don't have a launch camera in there holding it stable, if you're in a little bit larger pipe, especially if you're using it for those BMX tires with the large pipe, you can rotate the head of the camera in order to look up a lateral. And what will happen is it will flop over because it doesn't have the spring or the pressure of the spring in it in order to hold it still. So by inserting a couple screws into the bottom of this section of black between the body of the launcher and the head, it will make it so the head won't flop anymore. And that will allow you to get in and use it as a mainline camera. The blue and the brown cable end. This is probably the most common service area that I have. The photos are straight from the manual and they're a little bit earlier version. So the original cable was a red cable, which is now a brown, and it was a green cable, which is now a blue. So red and brown, blue and green, same cables. What happened was when we added the pan and tilt, we had to add 2 more wires in order to send that transmit and receive signal for the pan and tilt to function. So the cables changed color to let us know which one you're operating. When we connect it, we're going to use the wrench. We talked about not the force of Hercules. And we'd like to have a little bit of blue cable showing. And we're going to talk about that here. Generally, when you connect the brown and the blue cable, you want to end up with about a 45 degree bend. The manual would tell you that the clamshell here should be 2 inches from the spring. I would say it's more important to have a little bit of blue showing, or green in some people's case. The reason I say that is because if you don't tighten these screws enough on your clamshell, on your pushrod cable, your blue or your green, what's going to happen is you're going to pull on the mechanical connection between these two sides, and you're going to eventually compromise this crimped on connection. When you're running a lateral launcher full time, you're eventually going to flip your blue or green cable end for end, and that is going to end up with that possibly compromised crimp connection being the only thing holding your camera on in the lateral. So you want to have a 45 degree bend. You want to tighten your electrical connection hand tight plus 1/8 of an inch or so. A silly common question I often get is, how long is my blue cable? Well, if we go back to the Greeks, I guess it was the Greeks that did all of that wonderful triangle stuff back in the day. We're going to use the formula 2 pi r. Well, since it's 2 and r, we only really need to worry about the diameter. So we take the diameter of our roll of cable, multiply it by pi, 3.14, and of course, multiply by the number of wraps, that is roughly going to give you the length of your blue cable. One of the other things I find in service is that I end up with a mismatched set of pinch rollers. And some people are unaware that there are even more sets of pinch rollers. So we're going to show you how to change them out properly and why there's a selection of three. So this is the underside of your launcher, and we're going to use a 5/32 Allen key in order to remove the cage covering the pinch rollers. If you look closely, these ones are stamped STD. That's a standard size pinch roller. We're going to use a 1/4 inch or red nut driver in order to remove each of the four screws inside of the pinch rollers. When we remove those four screws, I just did one, there's a circlip right here. This is the trouble. A lot of people seem to remove just the top half of the pinch roller, and they don't remove the bottom half of the pinch roller. Two slot screwdrivers will pop that circlip right out for you. And then you're going to be able to lift the bottom section of the pinch roller out so that we're sure to change all of our pinch rollers. I'm again just going to try to see if I can get this video to run. It really does come right off very easily. Why am I saying that's so important? So what I end up seeing is that people have changed their pinch rollers out and they end up with a mismatched set. If you look at this post and think about that post like it's a fence post, if you were trying to take a fence post out, would you yank on the fence post to try to wiggle it from the top of the fence post or from right at the bottom of the fence post? You're going to wiggle right at the top. Well, if you put on a larger pinch roller, an oversized pinch roller on the top, then you're wiggling on the top of the fence post. So your fence post is going to come out easier. What that's going to do in this situation is compromise the seals and the bearings in here because you're pushing on the top of the post that's supposed to be holding your rollers. When you put it all back together, you're going to put a little bit of blue Loctite on that screw. Remember, Loctite does take about an hour to dry, so you likely want to do this operation, get things set up for the day at the beginning of the day before you leave the shop, so it has that hour to dry while you get to the shop. There are three versions of pinch rollers. There's standard pinch rollers, oversized pinch rollers, and extra oversized pinch rollers. They are stamped STD, OS, and OS2, as shown here. The pinch roller, the bottom and the circlip comes apart, just like shown here. And then all of this top section is more or less already assembled. And we use what we call a capture screw where the top threads have been removed so you don't lose all of those pieces in the field. Why are we going to change our rollers? Well, the push cable, the blue push cable, is truly meant to be used multiple times. Now, say I have an 80-foot long blue cable put rod. I'm not likely going to use all 80 feet all of the time. I'm probably going to use 30 feet. So what's going to happen is I'm going to wear out one end of my blue cable using it 30 feet over and over and over again. And I'm going to do that with my original standard size rollers that came with the unit. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip it end for end and wear out the other end for a little while. Another 500 launches. At that point in time, my blue cable will actually be smaller than it used to be, and it won't be pushing as well as it used to. So I'm going to change to my oversized rollers that the launcher came with. It's a very small package with what effectively looks like 8 parts inside, 4 pinch rollers and 4 sets of pinch rollers with the screws in them. Now we're going to change to our oversized pinch rollers. And we're going to run another 500 launches with that. And then we're going to flip it end for end and run another 500. And then I'm going to do it for a third time. So yes, you should be getting thousands and thousands of launches out of a set or a group of pinch rollers and a launch cable. We're going to get into troubleshooting. The first thing that we will do when you call in for assistance with troubleshooting is ask you if you've used a test cable. So the test cable, which comes with every pan and tilt or SR3, any of the launch cameras, is the LM306. What this does is plug into the back of the LM354 controller, which is where you had your mini pan and tilt, micro pan and tilt, the light knob that you set to 3 o'clock. It's going to plug directly into the back of that. There's only going to be one place in that entire rack that it will go. And the end of the connector with the white connection with 9 pins, P2 shown in the diagram here, is going to plug directly into your control unit. If you understand multimeters and you're going to try to look for voltages, you just have to realize that the wiring shown here matches this, but it doesn't read across like a book, 1, 2, 3. It reads 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 down in columns instead. Pins 1 and 2, it says that they're motor minus and positive, but in fact, they're not just motor minus and positive. They're also camera power. So at this point, you're able to measure everything and make sure that you've got the correct voltages and continuity from one end to the other. So even without changing to necessarily the test cable, I can take a multimeter and I can go to the back of my LM354 controller and put my two probes in pins 1 and 2. And if I have my settings set for the SR3, PS3, micro pan and tilt, I'll get approximately 20 volts. And if I change it over to the mini pan and tilt, I'll have approximately 24 volts. All of the CUES equipment uses regulators downstairs in the sewer in order to adjust the voltages. So when we're putting out 24 volts, we're likely using a 12 volt camera inside of the unit. The reason that is we don't know if you're going to have a 40 foot blue cable or a 140 foot blue cable. So we need to compensate inside of the camera that the longer the cable is, the more loss there will be, the more copper there will be, and we will lose voltage along the way. When I used that LM306 cable, I've actually eliminated two cables, one being the blue cable, one being the brown cable. So if I've connected my camera directly to my control unit and it's working, that's great. I know my camera's working, but I don't actually know if my red or brown cable has a problem, or if my blue or green cable has a problem. So I'm going to start in this case with the blue cable. And I simply put the two ends of it in a vise and then use my multimeter to check that pad A would be or have continuity between pad A to pad A, B to B, C to C. The other thing I like to check if I'm doing service is that none of those center pads, which are doing the electrical connections to the camera, are shorting to the outside case of that crimped connection. So I simply stick one probe on the outside and then just quickly touch every other pad with the other probe to make sure that I don't have anything connected. If I do, that means my blue cable has failed. Or if A does not go to A, my blue cable has failed. We talked about the pogo pins earlier. I didn't call them pogo pins, and I'm not really sure why they are called pogo pins. I think it's because they bounce up and down like a pogo stick when I was a kid. If you tighten everything too tight with the force of Hercules, then what can happen is the pin itself won't have any bounce left in it. This can normally be corrected by simply pulling the pin out. That's a pin pulled out, and then putting it back in. Normally what happens is the little section up here of bounce on the gold section of the pin tends to just get stuck against the lip of the electrical connection. So pulling it out, checking that it bounces like that pogo stick when I was a kid again, and then putting it back in. Careful when you do this to make sure you're over a table and maybe a piece of paper towel or something down there, because when it comes out, it'll come out all at once and disappear on the carpet and never be found again. That happens to be part number 1208 if you need them. Blue and brown cable end connection. In this case, my photos happen to be red. Pretend it's brown if you have the newer cable with the pan and tilts. We're going to take the spring section, which comes with this locking collar, which is similar to a crimp fitting in plumbing, going into a mechanical fitting in a chamber. A chamber we're going to add mylar to. If you don't have any mylar, you could get an old projection paper from your local office supply store, cut it to the right size and stick it in there. That makes it so that if you don't do a perfect job connecting all of your wires with the shrink tube, none of them will touch the outside housing of the chamber. You're simply going to strip the end of your red or brown cable about an inch long. It does have a coax in it, and the coax is going to have a center core, which is actually your video, and an outside shield, which is your video shield. You're going to solder all of the wires together. The LM925 kit gives you everything you need and the instructions to do this, and the instructions are also available on our website. It is a very simple operation if you can remember a couple things. The yellow and the purple are your video wires. So your yellow is going to go to the center core of your coax, the purple is going to go to the outside. It's almost all you need to know, because in every other case, you're going to connect the green wire to the green wire, the black wire to the black wire, so on and so forth. And when you're finished, you're going to have two leftover wires. Join them together. They will happen to be gray and orange. In order to put it into the chamber, you're generally going to do a 180 degree bend. You're going to do a twist as if you were rolling something in your fingers, and then pull it apart again. So we want this little loop to be in here. What are we doing with that? We're creating a little bit of a strain relief so that when that ends up inside of our chamber, when we pull on things, we're going to be pulling on the mechanical connections instead of our electrical connections. You will have also noticed that the yellow and the purple wires, if you were using a new connection, new connector, will be slightly longer than the others. That is a technique CUES uses in almost every situation where we're doing coax. We make the coax wires just ever so slightly longer so that then when you are pulling on things and inadvertently set up your tow cables and things wrong, you'll be pulling on all the other connections equally, more so than the coax, which is a more fragile wire. When you go to connect everything together, the tool and the LM925 kit that comes basically tells you you're not going to tighten this spring end connection super tight to the nut. If we go back to this area, you'll see this compression fitting inside. That compression fitting is exactly the same sort of thing as you use in plumbing in order to hold a fitting on the end of a copper pipe. It will actually compress on the brown cable, and the two wires in there that are smaller than all the other ones, which are the transmit and receive wires for your pan and tilt, can actually be compromised by squishing on them. So you're going to use the tool to tighten it. And then at the point where you really can't get the tool out anymore, you're just going to back it off, pull the tool out, and put it back to where it was. If you've lost the tool, it basically means leave two or three threads between your spring connection and your chamber, and then you won't be compromising with the pinch of those two wires, the transmit and receive. Again, after that, we want to set up our tow cables, our clamshells at both ends, to have approximately a 45 degree bend so that when we pull on things, we're going to be pulling on our tow cables as opposed to our electrical cables. And we do want to leave that little bit of blue in there so that we're not going to be pulling on our electrical connection. Throughout all of this, there was a lot of electrical connections. And pretty much every time you could see one of those electrical connections, you could have added a contact cleaner. This particular contact cleaner basically covers a multitude of sins. It fixes all sorts of things. So if when you cleaned your shroud and you opened that up, some of that sand got into that electrical connections, this is going to cover that for you. This is going to make a better electrical connection in all cases in order to make the longevity of your equipment be far better than it would be otherwise. What are you going to do to get assistance. Well, CUES offers a whole group of people that the first thing you're going to do is phone them and ask for help. You're going to call our 1-800 number in Florida, ask for customer service, ask for tech help, and they're going to be able to walk you through the use of the LM306 test cable. They're going to ask you what you've already tried, what you haven't tried, if you have any other spare parts. If you have a spare camera, try plugging it in. Do you have video on that one? Don't you? What you have to do in all repairs is eliminate things. So you start with things. There are five things connected together. Get it down to three things connected together. Get it down to one thing. Well, that must be the problem. Customer service group is there for you in order to call in, get what you need. If nothing else, figure out which part is broken in your situation and get a loaner. Our aim is to get you working in a pipe, not always with your equipment, sometimes with ours. We want that equipment out there working, making everybody a living. Again, if you do have any questions, my email contact numbers are below, and the 1-800 number in Florida is 1-800-327-7791, and they are also always there in order to assist you, keep you working as fast as possible in order to earn everybody a good living. Thank you for spending the time with me. I hope this has been educational.
Perfect. Thanks, Larry. And that about wraps up our webinar. We want to thank you all for attending and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding our new CUES micro pan and tilt inspection camera, as Larry mentioned, please feel free to reach out directly to him. His contact information is on the screen. You can also always visit the CUES website for more information.